and Ronnie.
So let me introduce Mr. Architect Ashwin Kanodia. Ashwin Kanodia is an architect and a professional in licensing and interiors, and he has been working with DEM consultants. He has been working on projects, redevelopment projects, rehab projects, SRA projects since last 10 years. And currently they are working on projects amounting to almost 2 crore square feet of an area in Mumbai. And they are specialized in licensing. So, sir, we request you to please share your knowledge with us on the field of licensing rules and regulations with respect to high density area. So, the stage is all yours, sir. Please go ahead.
Sure, sir.
You can share your screen. Huh?
Okay, so I haven't actually yet gotten, the PPT presentation ready, but I have made some points on the base of Gautam Nagar presentation which the students have made. Can I start with the points?
Yes.
First of all, very, very important for a high density housing. The very first point is that we should look at where any scheme when we redevelop or when we go for the community building, we need to understand the access to the project. The very first thing I would suggest the students to start those to also look at the access, that what is the access to the boundary of your project that you are looking at. Second, this is a very important point as per the licensing point of view. Madam, this, all the...
Yes.
Okay, Ms.
Sir, Rekha, I didn't get you. You asked some question, Mr. Ashwin.
Yeah. So this all points are related to basic points related to licensing or okay. To a practical approach to a project. Okay. So this is basically I'm telling you why, because this makes your project little more practical, and you will understand in some time that this access is very important while you design any project, anything in and around SRA project or high density housing. Because all the services also plays very important role in the access of these such kind of projects.
Yeah.
Second thing is that I have seen the project that the students have also marked out the SRA building which is already developed there, and the slum which is also already there, and the students have also marked community centers, the masjid, the mandir, the market area, all that stuff. So while looking at the rehabilitation of all such kind of projects, the SRA norms permits us to do that you can have a building which height is permissible for 70 meters.
Okay.
Now in 70 meters, the SRA or high density housing allows you to make a building or a unit not more than 300 square feet. Now this 300 square feet, you can give it to residential and all the other ancillary uses, or any masjid, or any mandir, or any other kind of shops which is available on site. So the first thing for the high density housing, that they define you the area, the ticket size of the unit.
Okay.
Now the third point is that we come to density. If we go for high density housing, the density which we actually keep in mind is 450 per hectares. It's 650 per hectares. 450 is for your normal buildings where you have low density or medium density, but when you go for high density, it should be 650 per hectares. The range is from 500 to 650. So I'm telling you the maximum density is 650 per hectares in high density housing as per the norms in Mumbai. Fourth thing is, when you design a building with 650 density per hectare, then you have a lot more extra units also available. So it is very difficult for a small site for a site to go high rise and the open space between the buildings. So the minimum distance SRA has decided. Any government organization in Mumbai has decided for high density housing is 6 meters between two buildings. Okay. 6 meters between two buildings for 70 meters of height.
Okay.
And this has been acknowledged by also other departments like CFO, which is Chief Fire Officer, the boss of the fire brigade. And also by the parking department, who is also another department in BMC. So any building, when I would like to suggest any students who, when they design any building, they should also consider the open space should be 6 meters, because when the fire engine goes inside any building or any compound, the width of the fire engine is like around four meters, so it has to spread its arms and do the firefighting. So the angle to match between the two buildings minimum should be 6 meters. The next point, I would go to FSI. So when we talk about the 650 density per hectare, there are two kind of FSI which plays around. I talked about the access, which is very important. Yeah. Bylaws. There are, if you have less than 13 meters road, then you will be eligible for 3 FSI. And when you have more than 13.4 meters road, you can be eligible for 4 FSI. The maximum high density housing FSI in Mumbai is still now is 4 FSI.
Can you repeat this again once? What is that? Access is less than 13.4 meters road is, then what is
FSI would be 3 meters.
3 FSI, yeah. Would be 3.
Okay. 3 meters, and if you have three access
meters. It will be 3, right? FSI, yeah, would be
3. And if you have more road width than 13.4 meters, the FSI would be 4 FSI. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And not necessarily, if you calculate the density, the FSI may increase from 4 to 5. But right at this stage, I think so, the students can work with 4 FSI and do a housing scheme, a high density housing scheme. Madam, if you want to get me to touch with other topics also.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can also talk about we are not looking at SRA, we are looking at a redevelopment projects, but not a sale component. We are getting into little hypothetical here. So maybe a little minimum density kind of a construction is happening with a smaller size units, like, you know. So one side, Gautam Nagar, is related to that, and the other side would be a normal density in Baikala region and that kind of normal, 450 less, per hectare density kind of.
Yeah, less density.
Yeah. So you can just talk in between that, because we don't want to get into too much of SRA. Yeah.
Right. So, like if you go by the actual norms, all these things are the minimum dimensions which I told you. But when we go for a normal development, and what are the open, so the major role is the open space of the building.
Yeah.
The open, right now we are working with a very constrained dimensions. Definitely, to accommodate such a high density, because of the bylaws, we are not thinking about the architectural part of the building. the light and ventilation, also the orientation of the building. So because the land prices are very much high in Mumbai, and we have to accommodate all of them in one plot or in one boundary. So actual norms when you go for redevelopment, normal redevelopment, the actual calculation when you do should be what is the building height and what is the open space. There's a ratio of the height with the open space. So whenever we go for a normal development, we consider the height divided by 4. The formula is height divided by 4 for any normal development.
Actually, I'll just intervene here. Initially, when we were designing some few years back, it was like the distance between two buildings can be maximum height by 3.
Yes. So now yes. Now it has gone to 4. Huh? It has gone to high divide by 4 right now.
Okay. Now it's gone.
And and this is dependent on two factors, which is the plot area. Okay. The plot area and the width of the plot.
Okay.
If the plot area is less than 1,000 meters, then the height divided by 3 is prevailing.
Okay.
And if the plot area is more than 1,000 meters, then height divided by 4 should be calculated for the open space.
Okay.
So this is for the normal development. Again, we can get concessions when we go, if we can save our hardships that my building, I am not able to consume the FSI. So that is another thing. But for a normal light and ventilation thing, the government has also given us, this is the formula, so that we get good high light and ventilation and good orientation of the building.
Okay.
So this is the main criteria, open space, while designing a regular development and the high density development. So open space is a very key important role. Okay. Another thing, if you talk about the FSI for a regular development, everything is now based on the road width.
Okay.
So if you have road width, which is now the minimum road width you should have for any development, regular development, should be 9 meters. Should not be less than 9 meters, otherwise the government itself will not give you any FSI, additional FSI for development. And there are the ranges of development or ranges of the road set, there are 4 types of roads that the government have categorized. That this is the 4 type of roads, and accordingly you will get the FSI. So when the FSI is between 9 to 12 the road width is between 9 to 12 meters, the FSI you will get is two FSI plus fungible. When it is 12 to 18 meters, the FSI you will get is 2.2 plus fungible. Okay. And when the road width is 18 meters to 30 meters, FSI you'll get 2.4 plus fungible, and above 30 meters, the FSI is 2.5 plus fungible.
Okay.
I'm sure the students know the concept of fungible.
No, so that is what I was going to tell you. That can you explain a little bit about FSI? And also fungible FSI, just a little if you can touch on this.
Yeah, the fungible, the built up FSI and the fungible FSI is two different things. The built up FSI is nothing but the FSI allowed on a plot on the basis of the road width it is abutting to.
Yeah.
And the fungible is something which is additional benefit given to any plot owner or any redevelopment project or any public project on the basis of the built-up area they are consumed. So the fungible is nothing but the percentage of the consumed built-up area by the project. So it is normally given 35%, 35% of the built-up area. So the 35% of 2 FSI, 35% of 2.2 FSI, 35% of 2.4 FSI, or 35% of 2.5 FSI.
Okay.
Okay. So it is only a percentage over and above consumed over built-up area.
Okay.
So this is an additional that you have to get purchased from the government, and they will give you 35% more in terms of FSI. Now the built-up area, I'll tell you a short how the built-up area is distributed. I'll just explain you.
Yeah.
The built-up area is actually a component, or is a combination of two type of FSI. One is free FSI and one is purchase FSI. So if I take an example of two FSI plot, that a plot which I giving two FSI. So in that, one FSI is the free FSI. One FSI is the plot area itself. So one FSI is a free FSI, and second FSI, the second one more FSI is the additional purchased FSI that we have to purchase in percentage from the government and from the market in the form of TDR.
Okay.
There is a combination of FSI which we have to purchase.
Okay.
So this is the basic financial, the financial framework of an FSI. So this is how the regular development FSI thing is distributed. And I have also explained the open space because everything is now connected to the access and the road width of the project. So I just advise students that if you go for any designing project also, keeping this small thing, because it's a basic thing in mind that now everything is based on the road width. So if you're calculating any FSI, understand the road width of the project, that from where the access is derived from.
Okay.
Yeah. That's now my understanding. I think so. I have explained the basic things about the normal mid density and the high density. Any questions, madam, if you like to ask me regarding the licensing part or some socio-economic aspect of high density?
Can you just tell us a little bit about how much is the RG and amenity space and service area? Can you just have it in a normal
yes.
percentage of social amenities and recreational ground?
So if I talk about the high density project, the ground space is very less. Okay. There's a restriction of height, and there's a generally DCR has allowed us to go till 120 meters, which is about 22 floors. But maintaining such kind of building in a high density project is very, very challenging.
Okay.
So the normal development, so the people use the more of the ground area, and they don't prefer to go high. So I think that there is this need to be corrected in DCR also, that such kind of technology should be brought in, that high density houses should go higher in floors, because of which we'll get some RG space or some physical RGs on ground. Right now, which is happening is that we can give paved RGs, which is actually for Mother Earth. Now they are converting this RGs into paved RGs.
Mm-hmm.
So now, as per regulation, 15% RG is to be given on site, which is okay. Mother Earth.
Mm-hmm.
So there are ranges of, as per plot area, you have to give X percentage of RGs, but the minimum percentage you should give is 15%. This information is enough for a designing project, that 15% RG you should give for any project. Yeah.
Yeah. when we look at services and other infrastructure, road and internal road, so is there any norm for that? How much, or this Mother Earth can be also a part of the infrastructure also, right? Or no?
Infrastructure, yes, it's a part of infrastructure, like, because if we are designing such a huge site, then we might design a layout too, like a layout comprises of roads, RGs, community centers, any other common spaces. So yes, for a high density housing, that we will decide and we will take care of all these things in a infrastructure aspect of the layout. Yeah. But there's so no there. Yeah, yeah. The roads are not under 15%. If we have to provide open spaces and roads and pathways, the pathway doesn't fall under 15%. The 15% is purely Mother Earth RG, purely green space of the project.
And setbacks from the roads, what are the setbacks, the minimum setbacks from the road?
Setbacks, I think I think the students have shared a DP plan in the presentation. So nowadays, you know, can I share my screen, that, you know, how can you get a DP remark? Yeah.
Ashwin.
Yes, hello. Yes, sir.
There is one question. Yeah. Does municipality consider podium tops and terrace gardens as RG?
Yeah, they do. They do consider. But the Mother Earth required for them is minimum 15%. Over and above the 15%, we can go for paved RG, which can be provided on podiums or any terraces or any on ground or over basements on and stuff like that.
Okay.
Yeah. How can I share my screen? Can you see my screen?
No, sir.
So there is an option of present now on your right hand side below the screen.
Oh, yeah.
In the corner. So from there, click on it.
Oh, yeah. Your entire screen, yeah. Okay.
And then click on the screen itself and then share. Click on that box itself and then share. The share option will come. Yeah, you can see.
Yeah, yeah. So now, this is an online portal of any DP remark. You know, when you go to any site and you have a CTS number, this is this online portal, Municipal Corporation of Mumbai Development Plan Department DP remarks. So now, if I go. For any random, hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You can hear me. So, can anybody share me the plot area or the CTS number of Govandi or the project we are looking at?
So the plot of the other project is a Mathina Hospital, which is in D ward, E ward.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll just take the site itself. The ward, it's asking me that what is the ward, first tab is what is the ward of the project. So the project we are working on is Amist. The village which we are seeing is Devnar. And what is the CTS boundary? What is the CTS number to the project? So basically, I don't know the CTS number, but if we just select randomly that. Okay, I just selected 123 as a CTS number. So this first general plot general information tab is open. Okay, so hello.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, so if you can see the plot information, general information tab, there is an SM sheet and EP sheet. Okay, so when we just try to open this both EP and SM sheet. Because this is a question asked by Ajaz sir also, that what do you mean by reservation which is there on the plot? There is some denomination or some words like E21, ER22.1. So I would like to show the students that how you can find the meaning of that. So this PDF is getting opened. This is basically the sheet number. The ES means the Eastern Suburbs. You can see this Eastern Suburbs sheet number 17. You can see the left hand side. So this DP remarks, the sheets have been divided into number of numbers in numbers. So we are seeing Eastern Suburbs 17 number sheet. So this is a sheet which is given by the department while publishing it, and on the right hand side it is the numbers, like if your project is in EP, which is excluded part. EP means excluded part, that which is not been solved by the development department, that what reservation we should give and which is not sanctioned by the department. They are just having a tabulated form here, that this is EP numbers, this is modification numbers to that site, and the right hand side is the proposal which they have given for the reservations. So this is nothing to do with the reservations, but I'm saying that this is a nowadays which the DP is not sanctioned properly or not fully. So these are the list that which are the sites which are not sanctioned on the right hand side of the sheet. And if you go below the sheet, you will see all the reservations name in detail. You know, so the hatch one is the existing, and without hatch is the proposed reservation. So for the existing, if you see for education, we have E1.1 municipal school, E2.1 college. For health, we have this denomination for the reservation. You know, these are the nomenclatures of the reservation which you can see on the DP plan, and you can relate it with this legend. And once we are looking what we are looking for, I'll just explain you. So the question was ER1, right? Am I right, Ijaz sir?
Yes, we just the question was whether the podium FSI can be counted in the the podium RG, can that be counted as an RG? But as you said, it can be counted as over and above FSI, over and above area, but 15% has to be purely on the ground area.
He's asking about the reservation, plot reservation.
Yeah, I just opened the presentation. So the study which is done by the students.
Yeah.
Yes, sir, it's ER21 that they wanted to know.
Just opening it one second.
Yeah. 2.1. No, 2.1, sorry.
I think so. It's taking time to download. So, yeah, they're not.
Hello.
I think his screen got exited. Matlab, he has exited. I have just messaged him that your screen is not being seen. Okay.
Hello.
Yes, Ashwin, you have joined. You can share the screen.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so now what we are looking at is a housing which is hatch part. Okay, so you can see this R1.1, R1.2, R1.3, R1.4. I think so R2.1 is our site. If I'm not wrong, it's rehabilitation and resettlement. So it's already it's already hatch portion and it is ER2.1. Hello.
Yes, sir, you're audible, sir.
Yeah, so what do you mean? The meaning of this ER2.1 is it is existing R2.1. Existing R2.1 means that it is existing rehabilitation and resettlement reservation. So if reading for right, reading of any DP plan, you can have this sheets online and you can see the reservation. For any reservation and you know the legend of any reservation has been given below. One is existing and the second one is without hatch, which is not existing, which is proposed. Okay, and all these things are, you can see the roads which are marked existing road, which is then whitewash, proposed road is in the yellow wash. You can have the railway denomination, which is shown here, the metro lines markings, and on the other on the right hand side, which is have a high voltage line, the buffer zones for the railway, the buffer zone line for the ward, the town planning scheme boundary. So all these are the legends, or the, you can say this is how you read the plan of a DP with all this supporting markings. Yeah, as so am I clear regarding this point? Adjust by Rekha madam.
Yes, Ashwin, you can continue.
Yeah. So am I clear about this point that which presentation was all about?
Yes.
The reservation part of it.
So Ashwin, I just want to ask you about this part only. If this site is ER 2.1, rehab and resettlement, so are there some specific rules for that, or it can be developed as a normal little high density housing also?
Right. So this question, this actually existing for any existing use, there is no such rules actually in DCR that we can develop this already existed site. But we can always look at to the slum project, the slums which are on site. But for the existing building which is already made, there is no rule to demolish it and to make a new one.
No, we think it as a hypothetical consideration, because it's a very high, very packed kind of a thing. So as a student's proposal.
Yeah, madam, over to you.
Hi Ashwin, I'll just read down the questions which students want to know and understand. So can we go with the questions?
Yeah, ma'am.
Hello. Can you hear me, Ashwin?
Yeah, Rekha madam, I'm not able to hear you. The voice is not. Yeah, just tell me.
Okay, it is being delayed. Okay. The question is, can we please understand what are the parking scenarios in the current high density plot, in this case of Gautam Nagar?
Yes. Yeah. I'm not able to hear. I don't know, the internet, the connection is very low here.
Ashwin, what are the parking requirements, or what are the requirements of parking in the given scenario? Hello.
What are the requirements of
parking? Parking requirements.
Yeah, Jasper.
Parking requirements. What are the requirements of parking in the given plot area of Gautam Nagar?
Parking. Okay, so the parking for high density projects, the parking requirements is for behind 8 units, you have to give one parking, or you can give one bike parking or one two-wheeler parking for one unit.
So 8 parking.
Four-wheeler parking, behind 8 units, four-wheeler parking is required. And for behind one unit, two-wheeler parking is required.
Okay. And also, I would like you, Ashwin.
Ajaz, am I clear?
Yes, you are clear.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, Ashwin. Now there are one question which I would want to ask. Now, now it's basically in our design studio, we have two design projects. One project is Gautam Nagar, which is going to be dealing with high density housing, and then we have another one in Baikala, which is a Masina Hospital. Okay, so we want to understand the FSI variation between the two plots. As what I know, for example, in Gautam Nagar, if the density is much more in the prevailing conditions, then the bulk or mass FSI may go up to 5. So if that is the case, or is there is something close to this, so can you please throw some light on this, Ashwin?
Ashwin, can you hear?
Hello. Yeah, I'm sorry. There's some internet connections problem, which is the problem going on here. I hope that I'm audible to everyone now.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah. Great. I think so. Now it's better.
Did you hear Ajaz's question, Ashwin?
Yeah, madam. Tell me which one.
Should I repeat? Should I repeat, Ashwin?
Yes, sir. Please.
Yeah, in our seventh semester design project, we are currently doing two projects in this semester. One is the Gautam Nagar site, which is a high density site, and the other one we are doing is at Masina Hospital, which is at Baikalla. Okay.
Right.
We basically want to compare and understand the difference between both as a density and as the FSI also. Definitely we will have more FSI in Gautam Nagar and slightly maybe lesser than that in the Masina. Want to know the understand between the two variation between the two plots with respect to density and FSI.
As I said earlier, the FSI for the Medina project would be based on totally on the road width, which we are abutting to. And for Gautam Nagar, obviously the same thing would be applicable, but for high density, we normally go for 4 FSI. So as per road width, the two projects would be, consuming FSI respectively, that they are abutting to which roads. So do you want me to explain again the road width? FSI according to the road width, which I have explained earlier.
I think there is a clarity because he explained very clearly about the road width. So that I think you can just go ahead with the other.
Yeah, and the density point. I would say that for high density we would consider 650 per hectare, and for normal design or for normal redevelopment or any hospital design or any residential design, we would consider 450 per hectare, 450 tenements per hectare.
Okay, Ashwin, the other question is, example, there are in certain cases where the existing or the rehab tenants are much more. So we may not be in a position to accommodate everyone in the 4 FSI scenario. So is there some scope available where you can utilize more FSI, or you can say bulk FSI or mass FSI, so that more units can be accommodated? Is there some provision, something like this?
Yes. If we have on-site slum which is more than 4 FSI, there is a compulsion from the government side that we have to recombinate the people which are existing on-site with valid documentation. Like they are residing there from last 10 years or 15 years. So they are eligible for getting a house, and that might increase the FSI. That's maybe more than 4 FSI. So yes, if there is more slums or more units on site or high density on site, we might go more beyond 4 FSI.
Okay, is there any permissible limit, or we should not cross 5?
No. For high density, there is no limit as such. But in previous DCR, it was restricted to 4 FSI. But in this 2034 DCR, the FSI has no limit for high density.
Okay, there is one question, Ashwin. are there any special provisions that need to be provided due to creek and dumping ground adjacent to Gautam Nagar site?
Creek, okay. So now you have, if you are abutting to a creek, dumping ground, I don't think so. Gautam Nagar is abutting to anywhere near to dumping ground. So,
yeah, 1.5 kilometers away from campus.
Yeah,
it is like 1.5 kilometers away. Yeah.
Yeah. So, if I talk about you, about the creek with you, like that creek comes under coastal regulation. If there is any creek or any water body around, that comes under coastal regulation. And the coastal regulation says that if there is any creek or a nala which is abutting your plot, you should give at least 6 meters open space from the boundary of the nala for your development. The reason, the logic behind the same is that whenever there is a need to clean the nala or to do any repair work or any other work for inside the nala or the creek, then the people should need 6 meters access road to do the, the cleaning of the nala, or they can bring in their vehicles to do so. And, the retaining wall is also needed there, so that if there is a high water level, so the flooding, the high tide line should not go into your plot. So 6 meters open space is required for any creek or any water body which is abutting your plot.
Okay.
Yeah. There is one question, Ashwin. Now we have started the series of questions from students. I'll just read it out to you.
Yes. Masina,
now I am talking about the railroad site, which Baikala site, Masina Hospital.
Masina
Hospital is a heritage building. What are the rules or some points we need to consider while designing within the same complex?
Okay, so if it's a heritage building, then I'm just talking to you is purely as per the practical approach. If it is a heritage building, you have to take an NOC from the heritage committee. It is a 10 members committee which is appointed by BMC, that you have to have a submission or give a submission that the structure which is under heritage requires addition, alteration, repair or redevelopment. So you have to give a submission to the committee that because of so and so hardship, we have to do either addition, alteration, either repair work or redevelopment of the whole the heritage building, preserving the heritage elements of the building. That is a condition for that's a major criteria for any heritage NOC.
Okay.
Yeah, over to you, sir.
Okay. And now another question. Rules and regulations for site due to metro construction on adjacent road, basically primary road. Anything to keep in mind due to this?
Yeah. So when your site is abutting to a road which having a metro which is going underground or which is over the ground, this falls under Metro Act, which is recently introduced by MMRDA. So the metro whenever the metro the site such which is abutting to the metro road, the open space which they asked for is minimum 15 meters from the fan of the metro, the tracks of the metro, the edge part of the metro, say 15 meters is the minimum open space should be given so for the dairy development.
Because we are talking about the metro, Ashwin, there are other spaces also where there are some regulations which differ, for example, railway tracks. Or, so which are the other airports? So just because we are going through FSIs and, development rules, can we touch on that and say how it affects these areas also?
So if I talk about the buffer zones, all these which we are talking about are the buffer zones, or we can say the service open spaces. the metro open space is just for if in case of any evacuation stuff. So the fire brigade should come there and evacuate the passengers from the this metro. So that's why this open space and buffers are required. Such buffers you can find in the highway on highways also. So highways also have a provision of buffer highways, which is the existing highway. There is a buffer line for highways also. In future, if there is a need to extend the highway, so there is a buffer open space given in DP. There is for the railway the same concept applies. If you have a need to increase the railway lines, so there is some restriction that if your plot is abutting to the railway boundary, then 30 meters from the boundary you can't build. This is purely because any extension in the services or for any maintenance part they require. So all these open spaces are, the logic behind these open spaces is servicing or the extension part of the existing reservation. So you find it in railways, you will find it in highways, you will find it in metros, you will find it in all the creeks and all the lakes, all the nalas. You will find it in the existing roads, setbacks, why the setbacks has been given. I don't think so anything regarding you can find this same thing in the national parks, if there is a national park like Sanjay Gandhi National Park, so 10 meters from the national park you can't build anything. Now in Thana, if you talk about, then there is something called as flamingo track. So the flamingo travels from the same track, so there's, from that buffer you can't bring anything or any high rise. So there is too much of, there's number of restriction if you start from Borivali to Thana, so there are many such restrictions if you talk about. So there, I think that would be a separate chapter if you talk about the restrictions and the permissions in such areas.
I have one question, Ashwin.
In
Masina Hospital, the plot that which we have taken into consideration has already a couple of buildings. One is the Masina Hospital and then one is a blood bank and the patriotic zone. Okay.
Yeah.
Then
yeah.
Certain portion of that particular plot has vacant area. Okay. Certain portion of the plot has vacant area. Given to the current scenario, it is being used as a place for COVID or COVID ward, or it has been designated as parking. So COVID definitely may not be there throughout, or maybe there for a specific time. So we have two vacant plots in the, we have two vacant premises in one plot. So can is it possible for us as a design project to make an accommodation or a housing for doctors in the same vicinity?
Yes. So if you have the reservation for hospital, the vacant area also have the reservation for hospital, we can do so. Yeah.
Reservations for hospital, but can we make the residential buildings or accommodation for doctors?
Yes, because residential buildings for doctors will come into ancillary use for the hospital. So hospital is the major use and its ancillary use is the residential building for doctors.
Okay. So does that have any special requirements or considerations while designing?
No, only,
what is the minimum, or is there any minimum case, or is there a separate density that needs to be catered to the accommodation for doctors?
There is only 50% of the ancillary use you can get from the total built up of the hospital. Hospitals, 50% built up you can build for a residential project for doctors.
Now there is another question. Will there be any height restriction, seeing as our road width is 12.5 meters? I think the Masina road is between 12.2 to 18 meters. In between that, let us consider it as more than 12 meters and less than 18 meters.
So the height restriction only arises when there is a question of a airport in the vicinity. If your plot is in the funnel of the airport, like the funnel. Funnel means the path of the aircraft. If your plot is in the path of the aircraft, then you have to get an NOC from the aviation, stating that what height can I build my building. Otherwise, you can always go, if you have FSI, you can always go above 70 meters, above 120 meters, which has been given in this year.
Are there any special considerations, Ashwin, we need to take while designing a hospital, while designing an accommodation for the doctor as an ancillary use? Does open space requirements cater to them also, or do we need to, or that can be exempted?
Open space required, yes, for the hospitals are different because they require a larger open space than a regular building. The staircase, everything, the planning consideration also have another rules for hospitals. There is a separate chapter in DCR for building a housing, for building a hospital building, because the specification according to them changes. No, so the building requirements.
Sorry, continue.
Yeah, in designing too, and in open spaces both.
If we are designing a residential or ancillary use or accommodation for doctors in the hospital plot, in the plot of the hospital, is there any special consideration that we need to think about?
Nothing. No special consideration. If you have a residential plus a hospital use in a same building. Only thing that we have to take care of the parking requirements for the residential part. The parking requirements is the same as a regular deployment. It's a table which is given in the DCR. If you want, then I can share you on WhatsApp or the.
Yes, you can do that. Please correct me what I know from the best of my knowledge. If the housing area is less than 35 square meters, then it has to be one parking for every four tenants. If it is up to 45, then it is two. 45 to 60 is one, and more than 60 is two parking.
Yes. So the same table, regulation 47, you can refer that table for parking, which is applicable to hospitals as well as the residential stuff. Yeah.
Okay. So there is one question from the student. So the density is 650 per hectare. Okay. Maximum density we have quoted. 650 per hectare. So if FSI increases, so how much does the density proportionally increases as per FSI?
Can you come again, sir? Yeah.
So the density is 650 per hectare. So if FSI increases, so how much does the density proportionally increases as per the FSI?
If the density increases, suppose if the density is 700 or 800 as per the present condition, then the FSI is as per the density.
Okay.
You have to give 700 tenements on that plot, even if there is a rule of 650. If there is more than 650 tenements, you have to give more than 650 tenements on site. Just as I said before, there is no FSI restriction for high density in new DCR. Earlier it was, but if the density of the site is more, and if we can accommodate it in one building or in two buildings with the respective heights, then we can surely give the density which is on site. There is no such proportional calculation for the FSI.
I have three questions, Ashwin. The first question is to make the students understand what will be the fire norms. As far as roads are concerned, as far as staircases are concerned, the number of elevators. The second thing is that, if we are talking about low cost and high density, are there certain parameters for that? Because you can't have, let's say, an 80-story building and we are calling it a low cost, you know? There are a lot of things that will change. And you can touch about refugee.
Okay. So, I'll just bifurcate the CFO or the fire norms in two parts. If we talk about the open space, the fire guys requires the two things at the most. First thing is the open space in the plot. So where there is a fire in the building, so they require they need to enter in the building and do the firefighting. For that, the open space required by them is minimum 6 meters. And if there is a high-rise building which is exceeding 70 meters of height, they require 9 meters, because they have a special engine which with a stairs on it, which spread its arm and anchor it in the ground. And you know, they have a very specialized ladder to go beyond 70 meters. So for such kind of high-rise building, they require 9 meters open space. The first part is that. Second part is that if the firefighting is not possible from outside, they need to go inside the building. So for that, they require a fire lift for high-rise building. For low-rise, the requirement is not as such. But for a higher-rise building, they require a fire lift which is directly connected from the ground floor to each and every floor, which is accessible from the building. I think, am I connected with your guys, or am I have lost it? Hello. So this is a part of the open space. Open space, yes. Why? Because the firefighting from outside and the fire lift, the firefighting from inside. Second part is that, yeah, if we talk about the interior firefighting, then the refuge area plays a very important role. Refuge area is given on every 7th floor of the building. From the ground, every 7th floor of the building is the refuge area given. And the area which is given to the refugees is minimum 4% of the 7th floor area. The built-up area, 4% of the built-up area of 7 floors. So that if there is a fire in the building, the people can run down to the refuge or and gather there, and the fire guys can remove these people from the refuge area to the ground. So the refuge area concept is formulated in such a manner. So if you talk about the calculation, it should be 4% of the seven floor area's built up area for in the building for every 7 floors. Over to you, sir. Hello.
Yes, Ashwin. Ma'am, yeah. Dilshad, ma'am.
Yes, Ashwin. Thank you.
Yeah. I request students, do we have any other questions? Students can post the questions in the chat box.
Ashwin, for the basement, yes, I was just wanted to ask, suppose our size is a little different grand and the height which we have in counties. Can we go for a basement?
Yeah, surely we can go for the basement.
So are there any rules?
So the basement should be purely used for the services as per the government is concerned. If you are developing a residential project, so the government gives you the permission of building a basement for parking areas, for storages, for any services like. There is a STP tank, there is a UG tank, underground tank, or there is any other services required in a residential complex. So the basement has been allowed for services, storage and parking stuff. And for any commercial project, nowadays they have allowed, like for the hospital, if you say, they have allowed labs, laboratories in the basement. They have allowed diagnosis center in the pathology center in the basement. So for the commercial project hospital, we can go as a lab area or a pathology area in the basement. And for the residential project, we can go for parking, for storages, and for services.
So is it necessary to have a ramp going down, or not? We can have a lift which can go down to the basement.
We can definitely have a lift. If we can't provide a ramp, which is much much more easier, we can have a lift for sure. No issue.
Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Ashwin, sorry. Just go ahead.
No, continue on.
The other question that I had was, if we have low cost, high density, height, you know, because it's not feasible to do a very tall building if it's low cost. So, in that scenario, what happens? I mean, you know, why can't we go high? If we can just explain that to the students.
Low cost, high, like this is are you talking about it from the licensing point of view or from the design point of view?
I think, ma'am, it's a very design oriented question. I think Mr. Ashwin will not be able to address that.
Okay, fine.
Yeah.
Is Sarah there? Sarah?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Sarah, can you please ask your question?
Sir, what would be the core area percentage of a residential building, depending on all the elevators?
I think Ashwin got disconnected. I'll just ask him to reconnect.
No. I'm connected.
You're there. Okay. Yeah. Sarah, please continue.
Yeah, yeah.
So the core area percentage of a residential building, actually counting the elevators, the staircase, the lobby, the ducts, etc.
So there is, okay, Sarah, thank you. So there is no such percentage mentioned in the DCR.
What she's trying to ask is maybe also how many lifts, like suppose the building height is 70 meter, then what is the number of lifts and fire ducts and fire electrical ducts? What all are the requirements, I think, and
that will determine the
fire staircase if you need. So whether the fire staircase has to be separate than the normal staircase. So I think she will have to ask that. I think so. That is what
So I think so. That's a pretty much refined question. Thank you, madam. So this is if I want to say you like that, that if your building height is below 32 meters, which is low rise, so you require only one lift and one staircase. Okay. And if your height of the building goes beyond 32 meters, which is a high rise as per DCR, then you require two lifts. One is a purely for firefighting lift, and one is a passenger lift, and a staircase. Which is having a fire resistant doors. So we call it a fire staircase. So these are three requirements for high rise and two requirements for low rise. And the percentage is not defined in this, it's as per your designing.
So the fire duct has to be, firefighting equipment duct has to be separate?
Yes. So this is. If you have a fire lift beside your in the lobby, naturally, so you have to provide a fire duct which will incorporate your water pipes, your cannons, and your hose drill, everything in that.
So is there any rule that beyond 32 meters, still 32 to 70 meters, it is two lifts, Ashwin?
Yes. If you go beyond 32 meters, you have to provide two lift.
No. And is there any provision that if we go higher than 70 meters, there has to be three lifts or something like that?
There is no provision for that. But any which ways, as a design point of view, we have to provide three lift, because the retrieving time for any passenger lift which goes beyond 70 meters is too high. So it's a designing. Yeah. So while designing, an architect would always give you three or four lifts, which is beyond 70 meters.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm just rearranging the question that I asked earlier. What I actually wanted you to tell the students was the difference in compliances between low rise and high rise. So what are the different parameters that would apply to a high rise building and to a low rise building? And secondly, the distances between staircases for fire norms, adhering to fire norms.
Yeah, so I just, I think so, for the fire, if I tell you that the lift is not required for a low rise, but you require an open space. For a low rise, the open space for the fire thing is minimum 3.6 meters. And one side you have to provide 6 meters for firefighting. One side of the building has to be 6 meters. For a high rise, there has to be a firefighting lift, and there has to be open space from at least two sides, which is 6 meters. So this is the difference between the compliances if you talk about the fire. When you talk about the lift and the staircase, I've already spoken about that, that you require only one lift and one staircase for low rise, and you require two lift and one staircase for a high rise. Any other compliances as part of designing? Madam, if you'd like to tell me.
If there is a basement and the basement covers the plot, then the staircases go to the basement, there is, you know, you will need a distance, right? As per fire norm. Because in a building, we are considering that you only require two staircases, and it's not like a continuous building. Yeah, that's why I asked you the distance between staircases.
Yeah, yeah. So this legal name for this is a travel distance. The travel distance should be not more than 22 meters from the fire exit to the last unit of the building. So the difference, 22 meters should not be more than 22 meters. Yeah.
Hi, Ashwin. I have a question that for residential area, or in case of mainly residential area, is there a provision that we can consider commercial activity if it is not existing, though? Can add a commercial activity to the residential zone? And secondly, can it be distributed along the floors, or it has to be kind of together at the ground floor or the podium level?
So the commercial activity is divided into a retail stuff and offices. Like, you know, you can divide this commercial activity. So if you are talking about the retail commercial activity, there has to be on the ground floor. Maximum we can take to first floor. And if you have commercial activity which incorporate offices or any other IT buildings or stuff like that, or IT offices, stuff like that, we can go to upper floors. So we can accommodate, yes, we can accommodate commercial in a residential user building.
All right. Thank you, Ashwin.
Yeah.
Sir, how much space in a building is counted under VFSI, like looking at the whole building and the plot?
Percentage?
Yeah. Or no, you can just tell me the area also. That would be also fine.
The free of FSI, if you talk about the free FSI, there's a diagram which I can share with you that how much free FSI you can get in a building. Like if you talk me about the lobby, then the lift is a free FSI, the staircase is a free FSI, the lobby is a free FSI, the refuge is a free FSI. So all the common areas, by logic, all the common areas in the building can be a free FSI component. But in detail, it has to be diagrammatically explained to you, like in a graphic form. I cannot explain you, while talking. But the logic is all the common space can be free FSI in a building.
What about podiums? Where are podiums allowed and where aren't they allowed?
Okay. Good question, madam. The podiums for the residential or any commercial user building, the podium is allowed till 32 meters. The podium is not allowed beyond 32 meters. Like for a building of 120 meters, very high density building, and you have a huge parking requirement. So you can have 10 podium levels, which is amounting to a height of 32 meters, which cannot go beyond 32 meters. So that is a restriction for the podium. And if you have a parking which is going beyond podium, so you can provide it in the basement. So podium, you can provide, the maximum limit for the podium is 32 meters.
Thank you, Ashwin.
Yeah.
have any other questions, students?
Ashwin sir, one more question that in case of say if we are doing it for Gautam Nagar, the redesigning, so many of the families living there are involved with small scale industries, like, you know, making some things at home. So are these kind of activities, can they be regularized and given a consideration under area, like maybe a small scale industrial setup in the building itself?
See, in a high density or a SRA project, we identify such units into three parts. First is residential units, second is residential cum commercial units, and third is totally commercial units. So we can accommodate this three types of units in a SRA project or in any other project. This area for all these three units are the same, which is 300 square feet. So if it's a commercial entity, it's a commercial unit, then the placement of the commercial unit should be on the ground floor, so that we have to explain to the corporation that this is a commercial, dedicated commercial unit. There is no partly residential in this unit, so the commercial unit has to be on the ground floor because of all other restrictions, the commercial support system, like parking, the working area, the shopping area, and all that stuff. So surely we can divide this stuff into three categories, and we can design accordingly in a SRA building or a high density building.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Do the students have any more questions? Okay. Thank you so much, Ashwin, for an absolutely fantastic session.
Thank you very much. Pleasure.
We may have to invite you again once the students have more questions.
Yes,
and thank you. Thank you so much.
Pleasure is all mine, madam. Pleasure is all mine.
Thank you, Ashwin, sir. It was quite informative. And
thank you.
We'll get back to you with our more questions if we have any.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you very much. Thank you, Ajaz, sir, for inviting me. Thank you, Jay, sir, for inviting me. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Ashwin, sir. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Yeah.